I think today is a really important opportunity for the community to actually come and understand how important the LARCH facility is. I mean, this is a facility that's been around since the early 1950s. We've been working with Department of Corrections, truly actually training incarcerated individuals out on the ground, how to fight fires, how to do forestry, mechanics, all those things, team building, leadership, discipline, and training so that post-release they can go out and have a job. What people also need to understand isn't just about them. They are key and critical, but it's also the fact that we have them currently down in Tunnel 5 fire. Tunnel 5 fire is a huge fire. It is a challenging fire, and we have right now over 40 inmates that are down there who are fighting these fires. It's 10% of our crew comes from LARCH, 10%. As we're seeing this fire season, then future fire seasons, and the one in the past growing more and more, and we're seeing more catastrophic fires, these individuals are absolutely essential at protecting our community, saving lives, but it's also more than just saving lives of the people in the community. We're also changing minds. One of my favorite stories, I'll be really honest, I have a really personal story, and it may not be about LARCH, but it is about our program with Department of Corrections and how critical this work is. You know, I was first on the job in 2017, and in 2018, we got a call for a flood. Okanagan River, worst flood literally since 1973. That Canadian snow melted so fast, every single community along that Riverside, Okanagan, Omak were flooding, homes three blocks in, and state of emergency called, and no one came. And I got a call from the county commissioner who knew me and said, you were here for fire, can you come for flood? And I looked at my people and they go, we don't do floods. And I said, well, we are now. And we sent our firefighters and we sent our camp crews, and they stayed day after day filling sandbags, getting that river at bay. And I was there as Memorial Day weekend, and they were when the river had been held at bay, they got a little bit of a break, but they got to stay in case it breaks, and they're out cleaning the cemetery. They were out planting gardens in the downtown Main Street, right? And I went to meet with them, and I said to them, there were many of them actually the age of my oldest son at the time, who was 20. And I said, what do you like better, floods or fires? And he said, ma'am, floods. And I thought, no, who would like floods better? It's messy, right? And he said, ma'am, every single night we came out from the flood and working tirelessly, and the town came out and fed us. They created an entire spread down the street, and they fed us. And this woman came up to me and said, thank you for saving my home. And he said, ma'am, it is the first time in my entire life I've ever felt value. And fires, most of these men and women, they can't be seen, right? Because community doesn't get to see that tireless, exhausting, challenging work, right? But on floods, they finally got to see the people who are saving their lives, and they are our camp's crews. And what's so beautiful is her mind was changed. She saw how valuable that person was in saving her home and saving lives, and he got to see for maybe the first time, as he said, the value of him. He will go on, he has gone on to change many more people's lives, and his life has changed as well.
Wow.
So that's the importance of this work.
Yeah, so if this ends up closing, what is lost?
I think the big part is, obviously, we can move people around, but the problem is this community loses that. Not only do we lose 150 people who work here in this community, who help train these men and women, but they're also the fact that they are right here in the Southwest Washington. It is truly ground zero for catastrophic wildfires. And the closer they are, just like our equipment, just like our air resources, our engines, our dozers, the closer they are to the fire, the quicker they can get on them, the quicker they can protect them. So what's lost is we will lose that resource right here in this community in Southwest Washington, where fires are so dangerous and can get so large. We will also lose the community that's come around them and says, we value you. You are important here in this community. And we want to support you just like you have supported us. Their families are living here. They need that support. We deserve their being here. And we have a responsibility.
How do you get through to the Department of Corrections? And because I believe, from what I understand, this corrections facility has been under closure before, but they first course. So how do you get the Department of Corrections to see the value and to keep it?
I mean, I think one of the most important, obviously there's an issue around money and funding. And I think, first of all, we already have 80, literally in the next few weeks, we will have 80 of our incarcerated individuals that are trained for fire, ready to go, literally out on the fire. 60 already, we're just adding 20 more, right? I think it's important for them to realize that every single minute spent trying to get to a fire is actually dollars wasted, and even more importantly, is a potential risk of lives lost, homes lost, right? And so I think we need to start really valuing the location of those people who are on these fires and able to get on these fires quickly, and make sure that we are not truly sort of getting rid of something that's been in existence for since early 1950s and changed hundreds of lives, thousands of lives, not only the lives of the people or inmates, but actually the lives of the community that have benefited from their work.
Fantastic. Do you have any questions?
Yeah. Did DOC have any discussions with DNR about the closure prior to announcing it?
We just got it a few weeks before, to be honest, and it was something that wasn't, let's have a discussion. We'd like to problem solve with you. We'd like to work with you to figure out how to address this issue. It was, this is happening. Here's the timeline that it's happening. So it was something that was being determined by them without our engagement and involvement. And I believe between the two agencies, I mean, I've worked with the Department of Corrections. I think they're amazing men and women who are doing amazing work. And at the same time, I also know our agency, Department of Natural Resources, truly believes in this program. We've been expanding it with House Bill 1168, which was, you know, that significant fire funding that I pushed aggressively for that passed unanimously, where $500 million is the largest investment in wildfire for the next four bienniums. There is a component in there for actually expanding our camps crews, and we've been expanding it. I'm hoping that Department of Corrections, along with this community and our agency, can come together and find a solution, because I believe there's always a solution if we really value the critical importance of having them in this community, right? And the importance of who they are and what they're doing and how they're changing lives, saving lives, and they're changing minds.